Good morning, church, and welcome to Where I Work. Hello, Salem. It's good to be back with you, and welcome to the wedding reception. I wanted to show you the place that I hang out most weekends, and this dance floor right here is home to some of the most beautiful moments, and it's so cool to take you. I love to take you in different spots. I showed you about every room in my house. And now we just keep switching it up. I gotta keep you rolling with me. So I wanted to take you here because love brings us to places like this, to beautiful wedding receptions. You know, love takes us to beautiful spots like a wedding. Love also takes us to hard spots. Love takes us to beginnings and love takes us to endings. This week, I'm doing this sermon for you. And I'm also doing a wedding this Sunday, and I'm so excited to just bless this couple in their first day together as husband and wife. You remember that, some of you? You remember that first day? That day that you spent just trying to take it all in? You know, the pastor maybe gave you a sermon, but you don't remember all the words exactly. Yeah, taking you way back. Or maybe you've got some kids, and that first day that you got to hold them, right? It's almost like you forgot all the pain before that, and maybe that's because you're a man and you didn't have to feel any of the pain. But ladies know it just changed when they got to hold their baby for the first time, and you were that person at some point. Love brought you together. I'm doing a funeral, and I ask that you keep the Nolte family in your prayers, and Mike Nolte from Ellsworth, and Dave and Eileen, and Kelsey, and their 2-year-old son, and all the family connected to that. Josh passed away, Josh Nolte from Ellsworth, after a 4-year battle with cancer, and so our thoughts and our prayers go out to them, and I get to walk with them in that hard spot, and all I know is that moment will be filled with love, because that's what a hard moment like that does, is it brings people together, and love has a way to do that like nothing else can. We're praying for Alan. I heard Alan passed away this week of COVID in your area, and we're lifting up his family and what they're going through, and we know it's hard times right now, and we know that love's needed more than ever, and we can send love to Alan and his family just by changing our hearts and our heads and our minds, and together, even coming to us in this virtual way, we can send love, because love brings people together. We're also praying for the harvest season and just safety with all that comes with that. I ask that you pray for me. I am going to be traveling here soon. So October, I think, 12th is when I'm heading. I'm actually heading to Uganda. My friend works with a ministry called As One, and he does some incredible things. His name's Andrew, and I asked him if he'd bring me along to see what he does, and the country opened up and it just worked out, and that's the plan if all goes to plan, but it is 2020. Who knows what the plan is? So I want to give you a little more plans too. Pastor Barry and his wife Margo will be with us soon and are taking over. They might be preaching with you next week virtually. It's either them or me, or who knows, that's the plan there. And then the plan is to get together on the 18th for Pastor Barry's first Sunday with us. So we're excited to have Barry and Margo join us for that Sunday. But I wanted to take you here because love brings people together. Weddings are, for me, it's such a cool part to be sometimes the officiant, sometimes a DJ, mostly a DJ. But in this role of getting to bless people with music, but bless them with kind words and bless them with just like, hey, let's take how many people and surround these people with love. That's what it's about. And maybe you remember that day. Maybe you don't. There was a pastor, maybe he was dressed up. I decided to, you know, dress up like an officiant, do my thing. And you could probably guess their sermon before they even start the sermon, right? The love chapter. Anybody want guesses if you're out there? What is it? 1 Corinthians 13. Yeah, the whole chapter. I wanted to take you there and I want to show you that because maybe you heard that on your wedding sermon, but maybe you didn't remember all the words because you were just starstruck or whatever in that moment. Sometimes I have to like snap my fingers if a bride and groom are looking at each other. I'm like, hey guys, let's talk for a second because they can daydream a little bit, you know? But hey, it's their wedding. They can do whatever they want. But 1 Corinthians 13, right? We've heard it over and over. It's about love, love, love. And those words, we can hear it so often and so much, that word love, that it can be overplayed, right? Like a song on the radio after you've heard it the 100th time, and maybe you didn't like it, but overplayed, right? Like you want to move past it. You don't want to really dig in to it. You don't really want to hear it again. Overplayed. But 1 Corinthians 13 is loaded. It's a loaded passage. And one thing I learned in seminary school, sometimes we call it cemetery school because it could feel like death, but hey, it can be life and death, however you dance with the scriptures. For me, I like to look at it as life-giving. Seminary school, they taught me to look up, when you're looking at a passage, what comes before and then what comes after. That's partially what's key. So what comes before 1 Corinthians 13? In the end of chapter 12, it says this. Now, let me show you a way of life that is best of all. Isn't that awesome? Paul wants to show these people from this town called Corinth a life that is best of all. I mean, don't we all? Don't we all want to figure out what the best way of life, the best ways to live are? Paul says, I've got it. I got to show you. This guy has a crazy story, a crazy life, but he's telling these people who are struggling with what it means there's promiscuity going around. They don't know what this love, this life looks like. And Paul has to say, let me show you this way of life that is best. So let's see how it ends. After chapter 13, he says this, let love be your highest goal. And I love it when the Bible puts an exclamation point in it, because that means like pow, like a punch. Let love be your highest goal. Right after that, it says but. Sometimes I like to circle those and I like to say, hey, that's a big but, because the but matters. The but says, let love be your highest goal, but meaning there's going to be some other stuff that maybe we need to learn along the way, but let's not lose the main point, love being the highest goal. That is our highest goal. This love is a way of life that's best of all. Now, to really understand this, I'm going to have to show you that Paul is trying to show us a deeper meaning. He's not being a poet, even though it's poetry. He's writing a letter to a certain people in a certain place, trying to show them the life that's best of all. And he wants that to be their highest goal, this type of life built around love. And I think he's got something more to say, because maybe Paul had the noise of the world, people saying it should be this way or this way. Maybe there's arguing going back and forth. Maybe there's some chaos in the world. Maybe there's a lot of noise, and there's something that could be higher than the noise, and it's music. Now, let me show you what I mean. Maybe I should bring my DJ. DJ, you want to get back on the ones and twos? Because that would be perfect. This is my friend Jamal. Jamal's a DJ. Say, what's up, Jam? Yes, perfect. Awesome, Jamal. This is the love chapter. Love is the greatest. 1 Corinthians 13. It says this, if I could speak all the languages of the earth, like if I had the most eloquent tongue, but not just of earth, and of angels, if I could sound so eloquent with my words and it sounded so good, but if I did that without love for others, I would sound like a noisy gong. I would say, Jamal, could we just show them? Let's hit that thing. Yeah, you would just sound like that. That's noise. That's not music. That means if you could be the most eloquent, but if you use your words in such a way that it's back and forth and it's noise. It's noise if you don't put love in it. When the ways that we talk to each other and to others, we have to put love in it. It's how we don't sound like noise. If you want to talk to somebody, do it without love. You'll sound like noise. But put love in it, and it'll change the way, because when you can treat that person, no matter what that person is or thinks differently than you, it will sound like music. He goes on. He's like talking about prophecy. If he knew all the answers, the faith that would move mountains. But if you don't have love, it would be nothing. It would literally, in the end, stand for nothing. The things that we do, we argue, we fight over, we try to find the right, best ways, we have to put love in it, church. We have to. If Paul says, if I gave everything to the poor, sacrificed my body, basically if I put myself completely out there, but if I did it for the wrong reasons, to boast about what I was doing, if I didn't love others, I would gain nothing. He says you would be nothing, gain nothing. It would all be for nothing. You guys know the chapter. It says love is patient, love is kind, love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It's not irritable. It keeps no record of wrongs or of being wronged. It doesn't rejoice with injustice, but it rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up. Love never loses faith. Love is always hopeful, and love endures through every circumstance. It goes on and on in this beautiful chapter. It says this in verse 13, that three things will last forever. One is our faith. Two is our hope. Three is love. And the greatest of these is love. Now I want to show you something, because remember how I told you it can sound like a song that's overplayed? It can lose its punch. It can lose its meaning. Well, if you don't know the language that this was written in, it might mean something different, right? Like he said, love is patient, love, boastful, kind, love, love, love. He said love over and over. You heard love, love, love. 1 Corinthians 13, that's why they call it the love chapter. It's because love keeps coming up and up. But the words that I just read in English were written in a different language. They were written in Greek. Most of the New Testament was written in Greek language. And in our language, we use love all the time. We just say love. It just means one thing. It means love. Like you might say, I love some of you, the Vikings, right? It's a hard relationship sometimes. Let's just say that. You can love tacos. You could love your job. You could love cats. I love cats. Some of you love dogs. Some of you love not loving cats or not loving dogs. I don't know. You love pizza. You love, we just say the word love like it's anything. You love your kids. You love your wife. But do you love your wife as much as you love tacos? Some of you might love tacos more. I understand where you're coming from. But we use the same word love, right? But in Greek, there's different words for love. So it's not just saying love, 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 love. It has inflection. It has meaning depending on the word that you use. And I think a DJ would be so helpful to help us understand this, because there's philos, and philos is a brotherly love. It's where we get the idea of the city of Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love, right? Philos. Philos, it's like you got your brother, like they're with you, like I'm feeling you, like this is my guy, you know what I mean? Like it's like a sisterly love too. It's like I'm going out with my girls. Love feels right. And Jamal, don't be afraid to not crank that for these guys. They need to hear it. The second one is a different love called storage. And storage, some of you might be sitting with a room full of storage right now. It's like people that you kind of chose some of them, but some of them you didn't choose. They just showed up one day. Like storage is like the people you're gonna store around. It's like family love. It's like these are my people. Like we are family. You know what I mean? Like storage is like this brotherly love, but it's deeper and it's like we're from the same clan, right? Family love. Family love. That's storage. Okay. Jamal. There's a different love, not storage and not philos. There's another love. Now, you know, I don't think this one I need to give too much of a write out for. It's eros. It's where we get the word erotic. I don't need to tell you too much about it because you know it's just a different kind of love. Like it sounds like this. If we were to put a sound to it, you know what I mean? Like, it just feels. It feels right, like you just be a woman and I'm gonna be a man, and you know what I mean? You feel right. Eros love, right? I hope you guys are laughing at home. And there's a fourth, and this is the word that Paul uses. He doesn't use philos, he doesn't use eros, he doesn't use storge. Every time he said love there, the one that's the highest goal and the one that's the best way of life, he said is this other word, agape. Now, maybe if we put soundtrack to it, agape, I mean, we could spend the whole time just talking about what agape is. It's one way, it's giving, it's unconditional. It's the love that Jesus embodied. It's so hard to put a sound to, but maybe we put it like this. It's the love that fills a room when a wedding's going on. It's like no matter what comes your way, we're your people. We love you. It kind of takes all the other loves and puts it together. And it's like this fully imagined love. It's agape. It's like when something horrible happens and a room is filled with brokenness and sorrow and pain, the love's in there too. Because it's not just on the highs, it's in the lows. And in the lows, it's like, wow, this doesn't make any sense. But what does make sense is the love that these people have for each other and maybe for the person they lost. It's agape love. It's unconditional. I'd like to say that we can do it, but really all of our loves in some way have some condition to them, but it's based on God's character. This specific kind of Greek love that's based on this Hebrew people called agape, this is a different kind of love. If you talk and you don't have love with the words that you say that come out of your mouth, it'll just sound like a gong. If you do anything you did, but if you do it without love, if you're just working, but you don't put love in your work, you'll be nothing. You'll have nothing. If you work for something, at the end of your life, you have money and possessions and things, but you do those things without love for other people and love for God, in the end, you're really going to gain nothing. Life can be noisy. It can be loud and it can make no sense. But when you put love in the things you do, it can sound like music. Marriage can be noise or it can be music. Work could be noise. It could be sound. It could be gong or it could be beautiful and moving and rhythm to it. Your house where people hang out and are, it can be loud and noisy in a place that's overplayed and doesn't want to be heard. Or it could be moving and it could have a sway to it and it can make you feel. It can be music, right? Your Facebook, your social media interaction, your political views, they can be noise. Oh yes, they can be noise. They can be loud. But it's not about being loud. It's about being music. Because if you put love into any of those things, they can be music. Music is so much better than noise. For Paul, it's what matters. Agape love, this one-way, powerful, giving love based on the character of God. We love because He loved us first. He first loved. Do you know how much God loves you today? Here's how. Jesus, you were so worth it that God would give His own Son to show you how much he loved. Jesus was music on earth, the way that he interacted and loved and handled and gave himself fully unconditional. You know, I read that 1 Corinthians passage, and when pastors get up and they have no life with it, I'm like, you're just missing it. You're missing that the passage is about joy and zeal, and it's about this amazing word, agape. But honestly, when I hear it, maybe it's because me and Jamal are DJs. For some reason, I like hear lyrics. I mean, love is patient, love is kind. It sounds like a poem, right? Love is everlasting, it will not end. Love will remain, love never fails, love wins. I think of music, I hear music, and I get moved by the poeticness of it. Love is music. Agape love is like a music that soothes you in those low spots, and it gets you hype in the high spots. It's the same type of music that I might play for a father-daughter dance, or a mother-son dance, or a first dance, right? Or music that comes on when a casket comes in or is taken away, a song that speaks way more than any intellect, any word. It just, the music holds our heart in some amazing way. Love is music, love is poetry. It has a groove to it, and when you see it, you can't help but move. You know, I was thinking, and me and Jamal were looking at this word love and how it ties into music, and we realized music is all about love. The top 10, the top rated songs of all time are about love. Like, those are the ones that move us. They say that all music, 60% of all songs are written about love. They're about wanting love, receiving love, wishing they had love, wishing they had an old love, wishing a new love would come around. It's like love, 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 right? I looked through our database, and we had over 2,000 songs with just the word love, the title in it. Love in the title, right? I mean, since the 90s, people have been asking, what is love? Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me no more. I think every pastor should have a DJ. Baby, what is love? But listen, that wasn't the first question, though. It wasn't the first question. People have been asking questions about love for a while. Is this love? Who do you love? What's love got to do with it? That's one of my mom's favorite. One of my favorites is, where is the love? Where are the black eyed peas when you need it? I mean, even Elvis, the king. Wise men say, he couldn't help but fall in love. Only fools rush in. And if you're swaying a little bit, perfect. Bob Marley, check this out. Bob Marley said there's only one love. Frozen, that, you know, it got a little overplayed, didn't it? But they said that love is an open door. Diana Ross, she said you can't hurry love. J-Lo's love doesn't cost a thing. Fellas, if you're broke, she said her love don't cost nothing. Even the kids these days, they're dancing about it. Right? It wasn't the first time. It wasn't the first time. Taylor wanted to tell hers in a love story. Whitney will always love. Lionel and Mariah, their love, apparently it's endless. Apparently, though, Beyonce and Jay-Z, they're not crazy in it anymore. I'm crazy in love with this beat, though. Love, right? We use these words, it's throughout music. Joan Jett, she loves rock and roll. Toby Keith loves this bar. James Taylor wants to know how sweet it is to be loved by you. So many good ones, right? There's all kinds of love too. Yeah, there was savage love. There's summer love, stubborn love, jungle love, good love, higher love, tainted love, baby love. Some people are drunk in love, addicted to love. For some, love is a battlefield. Love is a roller coaster. Love is a shack. I mean, I can't make it any easier than to just spell it out for you guys.
M is for the way you look at me. O is for the only one I see. V is very, very extraordinary. E is even more than anyone
exactly
that you adore can love.
I know you know the lyrics. Martina said, it's the only house big enough. Rihanna found love in a hopeless place. Maybe you can too. Maybe you did. Some people, they believe in a thing called love. Just listen to the rhythm of their heart. Right? The Beatles. The Beatles had so many hits, right? For all that time. They had Love Me Do, Can't Buy Me Love, All You Need Is Love. Now, husbands, even though some of you act like cotton-headed ninny muggins, you need to know this, that we can all see that she loves you. She loves you. She loves you. Stevie Wonder called to say, I love you. Huey Lewis and wanted to break the news, and he wanted to let you know that there's power in love. Tim McGraw wants some more of it. He likes it. He loves it. Even Lil Wayne wants to know how to love. Shania said this, and I think we can relate to this, especially as men. She just said, as simple as she could, don't be stupid. You know I love you. It's perfect. But the reality is some of you are stupid, and you do break people's hearts. And you just give love a bad name. Thank you, Bon Jovi. And as good as all those tracks are, Jamal, this is fantastic. As good as some of those hits are, it's getting rough out here because Selena Gomez, you know, some of the newer, younger people remember Selena Gomez. She wrote a song called Love You Like a Love Song. You know, isn't the love song to explain how you love? And then some of you might be like, yeah, tell them, you know, these kids, they don't know nothing, right? And you're like, what's good music? And you might say, you know, that old good country, that's good music. Well, listen, George Strait put out a song and he said, you look so good in love. And it's a beautiful song. But I'm just saying, what does she look like when she's not in love? Is that what you're trying to communicate? I mean, I know some of you guys have loved this and loving this DJ. The reality is this DJ has got us falling in love. Hey, yeah. I wanted to spice it up for you. I wanted to spice it up because we could go on and on. We were looking at this and it would be awesome. But I wanted to show you the highest goal is to put love in the things you do. Paul said, let me show you a way that's best of all. It's why we're here. So wherever you're at, let's hear it for love. Put your hearts up wherever you're at, if you're filled with it, no matter where you're at. And also let's give some love to our DJ, Jam City over here. Something that's better. Somebody say it's better. No matter where you're at, say it's better. Jamal, it's better. It's better. It's way better. It's better. It's the best way to live. Let agape love, this set apart love that's with you in the highs and lows, that means everything. That without it, it's just sound. It's just noise. It's just banter. But with it, it's music. Let love be your number one priority. This isn't a new idea for a Christian. They said they'll actually know which people are Christians. I don't need to tell you if I'm a Christian, because our love will be how people know. It'll be that love that Jesus embodied that affected us, that changed us that day, that Christ came into our hearts and our lives. And then he filled that love with us to share with other people. That's what Paul's talking about, sharing that kind of love. That's why he keeps talking about it. Love, love, love. But it's not just love. It's agape, agape, agape. This is the one he's going back to. And Jesus agrees. He said the number one thing that this is all about, they tried to trap him. And he's like, no, I know the word. He said, love is the thing. He said, love God. That's the first. The second is equal to the first. So basically there's two and they're equal. One is love of God, which you can't see. But how can you love a God you can't see? By loving what you can see, people. To love God and love people. It's now. It's what matters today. It's what mattered when you first showed up. You were loved before you even got here. Shout out to your mom and dad. You were loved from the beginning. You'll be loved the day that we rest, all of us. Right? Love is the thing. Love is the thing that sent Jesus to make a way in the whole thing. Love is the most important ingredient. Agape love. Check it out. It's the fabric. It's the bloodline. It's the support beam. It's the music. Love is the greatest. Without it, we can be nothing. We can do nothing. Without it, we miss it. It's the secret through the ups and downs. It's the priority. You get it? Agape love. It's the essence. It's the substance of who God said he is. He made it as simple as it could be said. It says this in the scriptures, that God is love. What we've been talking about, that agape, that's what God is. We're made for it. We need it. You need it. Your marriage needs it. Your work needs it. This world needs it. People need it. More than ever, you guys. Your family needs it. Your friends need it. This political climate, we need it. I want you to think of for a second somebody who loved you with agape love. Somebody who loved you unconditionally, just as you were before you even showed up. Think of that person as you sit there. Somebody who loved you with agape love. It wasn't based on performance. It was just there. That love filled you. It changed you. For me, I can think of a couple people, but one I think of is my grandma and how she loved me, and I'll never forget that. But how I keep that love alive in my heart is passing that same love that she had for me to other people. It's the same love that Jesus put in her heart, and that's how I knew she loved Jesus, because the same love that he had, she had, and I have. And amen, you have it too. We got to pass that around. It sounds like music when we use it. And music is needed more than ever, because there is so much noise. There is so much noise. Be music. Put agape love in what we do. Let's pray. Father, we come to you in so many ways. We've been noise. With the words that we've said, we've been hurtful. We've been argumentative. We've missed it. God, will you just remind us in this moment that you love us as we are, that you don't hold that score against us. May we invite your love into us, and may it spill out in everything we do. Remind us this week as we go to work, as we send a letter, as we call somebody, as we send a text message, or just do something that seems so minute and has nothing to do with anything. Will you just put your love in it? May it be the vehicle that you use to change the world, because it is the vehicle that you use to change the world. Agape love. And may it be music to your ears, to our ears, and to everyone who hears the message that you are love, because you are. Amen. Go in grace and peace, y'all.